ho, ho! Another very merry Christmas from me, Father Christmas, oh ho! You two elf servants, come hither.
Yes, Master! Father Christmas!
Remind me of your names again.
I'm Sugarplum Wing Fairy!
And I'm Honey.
Yes, yes, very good. Now, all the boys and girls and everyone in between have been very good in what has been a very bad year, and we'd like to deliver them some lovely presents, wouldn't we?
Like toys!
And the PS5!
Yes, yes, plenty of PS5s. Now, I don't know if you two had heard, but Mrs. Claus is implementing a new present quality control regime here at the North Pole.
What?
No, it's okay. It just means that we've got to have a look at these presents first to make sure they're nice and proper. Sugarplum, hand me that bag.
It's so heavy!
It's the emotional weight of all the stories we're about to hear. Right, let's see what we've got first. This one's titled, Welcome to My Parents.
What's all that about?
Parents? Welcoming?
Hush now, let's find out.
Hi, I'm Claudia, the writer of Welcome to My Parents, starring Rui Ricks, Oliver Udy, Jasmine Ventham, Ella Palmer and Christian Longstaff, and directed by Jack Ward and Amy Mayer. This is a piece about a girl who brings her girlfriend home for Christmas, and she hasn't come out to her family, but she also hasn't told her girlfriend that she's still in the closet. Hope you enjoy.
So, yeah, they know I smoke, but you can't make it obvious that I smoke. Like, I wouldn't smoke in front of them, unless it was one of those times when we all have a smoke together. But that's different. Oh, and our dog died last year, and Mum is really sensitive about it, so don't mention that. Or anything about dogs, really. She's a crier. What else? They love Johnny because he's successful, so we just have to hold on until Johnny gets here. And Dad, he loves buildings. He'll ask about the building in any story you have, so just make things up if you don't know, which you probably don't, so... But make it believable, though. What else? I've already mentioned Aunt Doreen, right? Yeah, so that... Just remember that whole thing with
Don't
her.
Worry, Tabba. I'm good with parents, and I'm good at conversation. It'll be fine.
My parents are not normal parents, though. I'm just warning you. Okay. I feel like there are so many more things I should warn you about, but there's no more time now, so all I have to say is good luck.
Chill out. It'll be fun.
Yeah. Fun. Gosh, never thought about it like that. It'll be fun. It'll be fun.
You're really jumpy. Is everything...
Tabitha! Oh, darling, come in. You must be freezing. Oh, and Tabitha, I thought you were bringing... You know, your special someone, your man, your...
Mum! This is my... My friend.
Girlfriend?
Yeah, that's what I said.
No, you didn't. You said friend. Hardly.
Well, it's what I meant.
Okay, whatever. Hi, I'm Cresdee.
Hello, Cresdee. So nice to meet you.
Cresdee? I thought she was bringing her man. What happened? Tabs, did he dump you? Are you okay?
Oh my god. You never... Tabit, are you hiding? In the closet, that is.
Mum! Dad! Happy Christmas!
And then Uncle Theodore collected the crystal from Nanny's house in Mull and delivered it just on time for the wedding ceremony. Isn't it wonderful?
Yeah. Wow, that's a great story. Lovely glasses.
Aren't they just... We only get them out for special occasions. Christmas, Easter, Ash Wednesday, Advent, Pancake Day, birthdays, weddings, engagements. You know, all the big ones. Whenever a glass of bubbly is in order.
Right. Yeah. Awesome. Pancake Day.
So, yeah, it's not a big deal at all.
Of course, sweetie. No biggie, as the kids say.
What's no biggie?
It's like slang for not a big deal, like no need to cause a fuss.
No, I know that, Michael. It is absolutely not necessary for you to patronise me like that. I wanted to know what wasn't a big deal.
The breakup with Dan. I was just asking Tabitha about why Cresdee is here instead of Dan.
Who's Dan? What breakup?
Right. So, no biggie, but I might have maybe definitely made up that I was in a relationship with a guy called Dan as a little bit of a beard.
Tabba! Of all the things you warned me about, you'd think this would be one of them.
I know. I'm sorry. It's just they're really conservative. And I just don't know if they can handle it. I genuinely think it would literally blow their minds.
Seriously? I can't believe you never told me you were still in the closet. A little forewarning might have been nice. I think this is more important than the Aunt Doreen story. Seriously, I've been talking to your mother about her bloody wedding crystal and her bloody heteronormative expectations for you and fucking homophobic Uncle Theodore for an insane number of minutes now, and I found it really fucking mind-numbing. So you better tell them that I'm actually your girlfriend. Otherwise, I don't know why I'm feigning interest, to be honest.
I know. Trust me. I know. They're incredibly embarrassing, and I'm incredibly cowardly, and don't worry, I'm not a conservative anymore. Besides the point, I will tell them very soon. I'm just picking my moment.
Tabs, darling, come over here and tell Mummy about Manchester. She's dying to know the ins and outs of student life, and so am I.
I'm sorry, and I really, really, really like you. So, basically, it's really fun. We have loads of parties. Well, don't worry, not so much anymore. It's not Freshers Week forever. but I really think I can get a first, actually. The history course is super interesting.
I just don't know where to put Cousin Ted, Tabitha. He's always the most difficult one to place. He's too antisocial for the parents' end of the table and way too old for the kids' end of the table. And of course Henry's fiancée is coming this year and we don't want to embarrass him.
Mum, Henry's fiancée is Ingrid. Ingrid, who's been coming to our family Christmas dinner for the last 7 years because that's how long they've been dating.
I know, but she's just not Ingrid anymore. She's going to be one of us soon.
Okay, whatever. What I'm saying is that she knows Ted, so he's not going to embarrass Henry.
Oh, shush. Don't be so heartless and just humour an old hag like me, won't you?
Yes, Mum. Just put Ted next to me.
Oh, Tabs. Always taking one for the team. So charitable.
Aha! I knew I bought two last year. So, Cresdee, what about you? Is there a lucky man who's swept you off your feet and gets you all to himself?
Actually, I'm a lesbian.
Of course, so no men at all.
No, that's sort of the point. Not really into the old stick and bone, slapping salami, doodle dasher, giggle stick, whatever you want to call it.
Right, yes, understood.
No offence to you though. Sure, it's lovely. I mean, I don't hate men. I'm just not the biggest fan of the...
Stop! Yeah, thank you for that insight, Cresdee.
Anyway, have you got a lady friend at the moment? Sorry, terrible with all the terminology. Don't want to offend anyone these days.
I have a girlfriend, yeah. But if I told you who she was, I'd have to shoot you. Or she shoot me. Haven't figured it out yet.
Will you just excuse me for a minute? Cresdee, come with me into the hallway, will you? What are you doing?
He asked me. And anyway, I'm not in the closet. And also, they're not my parents. Not that either of my dads ever cared that I'm a lesbian.
I know, but now when I tell them that you're my girlfriend, they're definitely going to think that I'm a lesbian.
But you are a lesbian.
I know that. But they don't have to know that yet. Ease them in. Let them think it's just a stage. Maybe I'm bisexual. Give them a sliver of hope for the return to men.
What? That is so incredibly offensive in so many ways. To bisexual people and to me, your actual long-term girlfriend. You want them to think that I'm just a stage?
No, of course not. That is just totally not what I mean. I obviously want them to love you and take you very seriously, as I do. But I also want them not to shoot me with rubber Nerf gun pellets from my old games box until I'm lying flat on the patio in the rain, crying out to God, asking him why he made me 100% gay rather than just 50-50.
Still offensive.
I'm sorry. Look, just give me the rest of the day. When Johnny arrives tonight, it'll be so much easier. We'll have backup. Johnny knows I'm gay, and also he broke all the rules before me and isn't fazed by Mum's high-pitched passive aggression and Dad's overcompensation of positivity.
That sounds insane, but fine. Would you be angry if I also said that I was a little bit excited to see that weird combination of emotions?
I think you kind of have the upper hand here, so no, I wouldn't be angry. I really like you. Like, really, really a lot. So please stay with me despite my judgy stuck-up family.
Shut up.
Tabitha!
Mum?
Hi, guys. The door wasn't locked, so just let myself in. Bit early, I know.
Johnny!
Johnny?
Tabs? Mum?
Cresdee! Sorry. Felt left out. Carry on.
Everything all right?
Oh, my shit.
Tabitha! Language, please. At least use the Lord's name.
That makes no sense.
Look, can we just not tell Dad yet?
Tell Dad what?
Yes. Tabitha, what exactly should I not tell your father?
Mum just saw us kissing.
Well, Tabs, it was going to come out at some point. Hi, by the way, I'm Johnny. Sorry about my family, including Tabitha.
Hi, Cresdee. Nice to meet you.
Cresdee?
Mum, don't be so childish. Look, Cresdee is my girlfriend.
Are you going through a stage?
Mum, that is so incredibly offensive.
That's what I said.
No, I am not. Granted, I was going to tell you that I was, but actually, Cresdee means a lot to me. And I want you to take this seriously, because I take this seriously.
Why do we have to keep it a secret from Dad, then?
Keep what a secret?
You don't want to know, Michael.
Why? What's happened? Is it Aunt Doreen? Is it Dan? Tabs, are you okay? Do you need to cry?
No, Dad. I made Dan up.
What? But I met him.
No, you didn't. That was Luke. He's my friend.
You got Luke to pretend to be your boyfriend?
Yeah. It was a moment of weakness. Dad came to visit.
Your dad came to visit and you didn't tell me. Tabitha, this is getting ridiculous. I don't think you understand how upsetting your lying is.
She really likes you, Cresdee. Please just give her a moment. She finds confrontation with Mum and Dad really hard. It's been a problem ever since she was little. And I don't know if Tab's already told you, but our parents are conservatives.
Not my problem.
And you. I cannot believe you knew about this all along and didn't tell me.
Seriously. Someone fill me in.
It's not really my thing to tell Mum. And I really don't get why you're so angry. It's literally nothing to do with you.
Nothing to do with me? Nothing to do with me? She's my child. It must be... I must have done something wrong to make her like this. Michael, it's probably your fault always letting her do the bloody DIY work with you.
Offensive, stereotypical, homophobic, generally rude.
What? What is my fault and what has it to do with DIY?
Tabs is a lesbian.
Johnny! I thought we just agreed we weren't going to tell him.
Yeah, but then he walked in.
I can't believe it.
Oh, is that what all this fuss is about? Tabs, darling, I couldn't give a flying fuck what you do in your bedroom, nor do I want to know about it. I love you no matter who's up in your sheets. We all just need to smile and move on. Does anyone want a cup of tea?
What?
Dad, the slang thing needs to stop.
Thank you. See? No fucks flying anywhere. Nothing to worry about.
Cresdee, I'm sorry that you had to be here for this strange family circle time. Would you like a cup of tea?
I would love one. But really, I feel I should stay. It is about me.
You? But we already know you're a lesbian. Oh, you're a lesbian and Tabitha's... a lesbian. Right, you must be Dan.
Well, I'm still Cresdee. But yeah, you're hovering around the right area.
The crackers!
Fuck, sorry. Didn't know she'd faint there.
You can be the one who gets the new ones. Oh, come on, Jonathan. Never put the Christmas cracker boxes down. We already learnt that. We're not Doreen.
Look, There is no need to be so dramatic. It is really not a big deal. And actually, Mum, you're being really rude. Not just to me, but to Cresdee. When I bring home the love of my life, no matter what, I expect you to be kind and welcoming, and this is the opposite of kind and welcoming. So I am going to the kitchen. We are all going, and you can come and apologise when you've grown up and thought about how you're coming across. Come on, everyone. Let's go.
The love of your life.
Darling, cup of tea while you're thinking about what you've done.
Oh, shut up, Michael.
And then the newt swam behind the rock and it didn't move for 9 minutes and 34 seconds. When it did move, it only repositioned its tail, then it stayed still for another 3 minutes and 15 seconds. After that, it swam off again down the stream, and that's when I lost it and my observation ended.
Wow. Wow.
I know. Exciting.
Don't mind if I steal Cresdee away for a minute, do you, Ted? How's it going?
He is so boring. I cannot believe he's only 22.
I know. So boring. So, I was thinking and I wanted to apologise. I don't know why I was being such a wimp. And I realised it was so shit of me. I mean, so shit. It's like, my family are so not your problem, and I really fucking threw you in the deep end, and then closed the pool cover over your head.
Bougie analogy.
Anyway, I'm sorry. I want to make it up to you.
Don't worry. It's fine. It's my own fault for being your first girlfriend. And I get... Well, I don't get it, but I can imagine how difficult it is. I just hope you are actually comfortable with this. With us. I know it's silly, but I really like you. And I'm not taking this relationship lightly, whatever that means. I just want to know that inviting me for Christmas actually means something to you, like it does to me.
Of course it does. I am so not taking this lightly. I mean, I understand how it may seem that way. I sort of shimmied you in and tried to keep you under wraps and all. But really, they know now. And even though Mum put you next to Ted and is still doing that passive-aggressive thing when she says your name a lot really loudly. Sorry about that, by the way. They love you. Dad told me that Mum is over it. Sort of. And she is actually really embarrassed about the way she acted.
It was quite funny, to be fair to her.
Wasn't it? I can't believe that was her actual reaction. She is such a stereotype. I love you.
You love me.
I love you. And I meant it. You are the love of my life. Well, so far that is, so don't get ahead of yourself.
I love you too.
All okay over here?
All okay.
Brilliant. Sticky toffee pudding time, I think. Go and turn the lights out while I drink half this brandy.
Hello, I am Ido Rosen, the token Jewish guy who is here to remind you that there are other holidays happening around this time of the year, except Christmas. Some of them are pretty good holidays, which, frankly, I'm surprised that most of you decided to give up on. So, I wrote a play that is called Why Jesus Hated Celebrating Hanukkah. I want to thank the team members that helped making it, the director and editor, Jenny Hay, and the cast, Peter Durman as Jesus, Christian Longstaff as Joseph, Yael Rimon as Mary, Matt Davis as John, Witt, Gregory Miller as the narrator, and the choir members, Emily Coatsworth, Julius Kill, Greg May, Lydia Roberts, and Alex Carter, who is also the arranger. Enjoy!
It was now winter, and Jesus was in Jerusalem at the time of Hanukkah, the festival of dedication. John 10:22, New Living Translation.
Honey, I'm home.
Oh, hi, Joe, you're home early. Slow day at the carpentry?
I think you are a bit confused, my little lacquer. I closed early because there's a holiday tomorrow and we ought to be ready.
Oh, right. It completely slipped my mind.
Say, was that Mr. Abramson I saw leaving from the back door a moment ago?
What? Mr. Abramson? Why would he be here in our house?
I don't know. He was only half-dressed. I thought maybe he came by to borrow one of my nice shirts for the celebration at the synagogue.
Oh, yes, that is exactly what happened. I'm really at sixes and sevens today. I think it's because I don't get enough B12.
Yes, sorry, I went to the pier, but the fisherman said their nets are empty. It would take a miracle to get fresh fish in time for our holiday meal. Any luck at the market?
Oh, sorry, I haven't been there yet.
Well, if you are too busy, why won't you send Jesus? Where is the little rascal anyway? Still isolating in his room? It's not healthy, you know. I can guess what he's doing there, all by himself.
Jesus, come say hello to your dad.
I'm in the middle of something.
Now, Jesus.
Hello, Joseph.
Hello, Jesus. Did you have a productive day?
I'm doing God's work.
I prefer you do some housework. We need to prepare a holiday meal, you know.
I could feed 5,000 people at the snap of my fingers if I wanted to. But I'm working on something a lot bigger than that.
I'm sure you are. When was the last time you went out of this house? Got some sunlight?
That's none of your business.
I get with the mood. That's no way to speak to your dad, Jesus. Your only dad and maker, who is certainly blood-related to you, his next of kin. He is right. Why won't you go outside and play dreidels with your pal?
Because I'm not a kid anymore, and I don't give two shits about fucking dreidels.
Mind your language, punk. Where does he pick up these words?
Certainly not by me. I'm a virgin.
No, I didn't mean to suggest that it was your fault, dear.
Good, because I blush just by hearing the F word. Any F word, really. That's why I can never buy fish at the market. Oh, fudge, I just said an F word. Oh, and another one. Oh.
That's all right, dear. As I told you, I'll take care of the shopping. As I take care of all the chores in this house. It's not a problem, really.
Oh, you are an angel, Joe. I don't know what I would have done without you. Oh, I could kiss you right now.
Well, please, don't let me stop you from doing that.
Oh, cutie, I really would like to, but, you know, I am a virgin, and I'm still uncomfortable to display affection physically.
Well, dear, you know that I can wait as long as it takes, but maybe if you had hugged Jesus more often, he wouldn't be so emotionally disturbed.
Lick my sandals, Joseph.
Jesus, please, go play outside. You should be celebrating Hanukkah with your pals.
What friends, Mary? Face it, this freak is a complete outcast. They tried to stone him earlier this week. That's why he hides in his room.
Stone him?
Yeah, he's been walking around the neighbourhood claiming he cured blind Mr. Levy. No wonder he doesn't fit in.
Jesus, can't you just talk to them about sports or something? Please try to blend.
I don't care about sports, Mother.
You really shouldn't listen to the Gentiles. You can't be Jewish and athlete. Look at the brave Maccabees, huh? Whose tales we tell in Hanukkah? Do you think they would have the strength to save the temple if they just sat in their room all day?
The Hanukkah fairy tales are just bullshit they tell to kids. I bet Judah and Maccabee never even really existed.
Blasphemy! You should be ashamed of yourself. You are the biggest self-hating Jew I have ever encountered.
Jesus H. Tap-dancing Christ! You will get your skinny tushy out to the market and do some shopping this instant!
Johnny!
Bugger.
Johnny boy, wait up!
Jesus, how are you, dear friend?
Fine, I haven't seen you in a while. Oh, smashing we can finally catch up.
Sure, sure. But, like, do you mind if we would enter this alley and not, like, stand here in the middle of the street?
Sure, a quieter place.
Yep. Yeah, that's why. And maybe if you could stand behind this big pile of barrels? Yeah, that's a good spot. So, how are you?
Man, I am so sick and tired of Mum and Joseph treating me like a baby.
Oh, how is your mum, by the way? Would you tell her I said hi?
She sent me out to do some shopping for frickin' Hanukkah.
Well, what's wrong with Hanukkah?
Are you kidding me? That's like the opposite of what a fun holiday should be like. Most of our holidays are like, remember that time the Jews were miraculously saved from genocide? So depressing. Hashtag cancel Hanukkah.
What?
What? I didn't say hashtag.
What? Fine. So, what's your idea of a holiday?
Well, for start, it wouldn't be a boring history lesson about what happened to here at old times. In fact, it should be set as far from my house as possible. I'm talking a whole different setting than here. In this arid desert. The complete opposite. Like all snowy and icy. Like the North Pole.
Dude, I don't even know where the North Pole is. The northest I've ever been is the Galilee.
And instead of Hebrews, the people there would be like magical elves. Yeah, and they'd live with this fat, jolly man.
So random, man?
Fat and jolly, not like Joseph, who's skinny and grumpy. Because he's poor. Oh, and instead of all the sand, there should be forests. Like, trees would be a major part of the celebration. Every family would get a tree and put it in their living room.
Dude, how much wine were you drinking?
No, bear with me. Not just a regular tree. You would, like, decorate it, hang small painted glass and, porcelain dolls of like, angels and stars and stuff.
Okay, dude, I'm not judging. And not that there's anything wrong with that. But what you are describing is, like, totally gay. Decorating trees? Porcelain dolls? Do you think people would bother to do that instead of eating deep-fried donuts and playing with fire like we do in Hanukkah?
Yeah, because, wait, I still haven't told you about the gifts.
Oh, there are gifts?
Tons of gifts. You place them under the tree.
Oh, so that's what the tree is for. You should have said so earlier. Now that's more like it, with many gifts.
Yeah, so many. So many, man. They even put gifts in your socks.
Dude, that's crazy. That's crazy.
I know. That's like the best holiday ever. That's the thing. I just wish I was put in charge of this stuff. If I had the opportunity, I'd decide on a special day.
But man, everyone has a special day.
I don't.
Of course you do, silly. It's your birthday. We could do all of this for your birthday. That's like your special day, right? When you get to set the rules.
Holy me, you're right. It's my happening, baby.
You remember last year when you were all like, it's my party and I'll cry if I want to. Cry if I want to.
Yes, yes, I remember. Well, I'll tell you what. From now on, my birthday parties are gonna be the shit.
Oh, there you are. Did you manage to get some fish? I mean, food. I mean, stuff. The stuff that we needed?
Yes, it's in the icebox.
Wait a minute, what's the rush? Is everything okay?
Everything is super. Mum, next week I'd like to invite some friends over to celebrate my birthday and throw a party here. Is that okay?
A birthday party? With people coming over? Of course that's okay, that is great! You'll have to ask your dad as well, but I'm sure he wouldn't mind. I'll bake a cake, I'll prepare whatever you want!
Oh, you're the best, Mum. I'll need a tree.
Sure, a tree. Oh, wait, what?
I'll explain later. I have so much preparation to do. But I want to put a decorated tree in the living room.
I don't know, dear. How did you think of doing that?
Oh, well, I still haven't worked out the details. Oh, no, but a tree is a must.
We could make it in my carpentry, and I could ask my wood supplier to get us a nice big tree.
Really? You'd do that for me?
Sure, kid. I'm hurt that you'd even ask. I don't know why you keep thinking I'm against you. I'm just trying to help and do what's best for you, even when you don't see it like that.
Well, I appreciate it. Thanks, Joe.
Oh, I can't help it.
And you're always welcome to have your friends over. In fact, I hope to see them here a lot more often from now on. They're invited to join us for holiday meals this week as well.
That's what the holidays are all about. Celebrating with our loved ones around something that brings us together.
Well, thank you. Oh, I have so much to do. I better start right away. Love you. Bye.
I don't know what got into him. It's holiday spirit, I guess. Anyway, that was very sweet of you.
Look, I am supportive because it finally gets him out of his room and socialising. But honestly, Mary, this whole mega birthday celebration, it's megalomaniac, don't you think?
He is just enthusiastic, that's all. Don't exaggerate. It is perfectly normal. All boys have messianic urges at this age. It's the raging hormones.
Just make sure to keep things in the right proportions. I mean, in 2,000 years from now, Jews all over the world will still be celebrating Hanukkah. But who would ever even hear about Jesus?
You'll just keep backing him up no matter what, and I'm telling you, with love and support, there's nothing this kid couldn't do.
Hi, I'm Ffion Godwin, and I'm the writer of Aligned, starring Claire Walsh and J.K. Wainwright. It's about how two people's lives unexpectedly cross and how it helps them in ways they could never have imagined. I hope you enjoy.
Dad, look, I'm so sorry. Please don't.
Hello?
And I do appreciate you, and know you just want to help.
Hello?
Wait. Oh God, is this the wrong number? Sorry.
Hello?
Dad, look, I'm so sorry.
Jennifer?
It's Grace. Who's Jennifer?
I think this must be the wrong number. Goodbye.
Wait! Did I just ring you?
I think so.
Sorry. Do I know you? I was just trying to ring my dad. Is he there?
I'm Mr. Fielding. I don't think I know your father.
Or I must have typed his number wrong. It's a new phone.
I don't mean to be rude, but I must go. I'm trying to find my Jennifer.
Oh. Okay. I hope you get through.
Thank you. Goodbye now.
Dad! I rang you like twice and you didn't pick up.
Jennifer, is that you?
Mr. Fielding?
Oh, God.
Our phones must be messed up.
Yes.
Have you updated yours? There's a new iOS.
I'm not great with stuff like that. I don't really know what that means. It might be my fault. This phone box isn't great.
Phone box? I haven't used one of those before.
Really? What are you using now, then?
My iPhone. What?
This is just a prank, isn't it, Jennifer? You've really got me this time. Please, come home. Let's talk about this.
Sorry, I'm Grace. Grace Earnshaw.
Oh.
And I think something's gone wrong because every time I try and ring my dad, I get through to you.
Look, if this is a joke...
It's not a joke.
Please stop. She's run away. I need to find her. Please. It's Christmas Eve. Where are you?
I'm in London. West London.
Me too. You don't know her?
It's quite a big place. I don't think so.
Are you in the same class? Do you go to St. Geraldine's?
In her class? No. I left school, like... And it's called Riverview High. It hasn't been St. Geraldine's since my parents went there.
But that's what it's called now.
I walked past yesterday.
What?
Strange.
She might be in the Flowerpot Cafe next to the station.
You mean Costa?
No, I mean the Flowerpot Cafe. The one with all the plants in the window.
Costa's been there since 2010, because that's when I moved here.
What year is it right now?
2020.
I hope that's all part of your joke. It's 1980 bloody two!
That's not possible.
It's 1982! I don't believe you. I don't believe you.
Okay. So this has got a bit weird. I'm going to hang up now.
Wait!
I need to phone my dad right now. I'm just a bit freaked out, so I'm just going to hang up now.
Please! If the only person I can get on the phone is you, then please help me.
I don't know what I can do. I'm sure my own dad is trying to call me right now to find out where I am.
You ran away.
What?
You ran away. My Jennifer. My Jennifer has gone.
I'm sorry.
I don't know what to do.
Look, I don't know how to help you. I don't know you. I'm sorry.
I'm just asking for your help. It's Christmas Eve. Please.
I can't be long.
Of course.
Why did she leave?
I don't know.
Okay.
She hasn't written in weeks. I'm surprised she even showed up in the first place.
Maybe she just needs some space.
She just left.
Did she say where she was going?
No.
She probably didn't go far. I wasn't planning on going far.
You ran away.
What?
You ran away.
I'm sorry. I don't know how...
Please, help me understand. Why did you run away?
I think I just don't want to, like, go backwards, you know?
Go on.
I'm not a child anymore.
No.
So, after all this change in my life, I don't want to feel like I'm moving back to where I started.
That's not backwards. That's just coming home.
But this is home. Here. With me and my work and my flatmates who won't ask me endless questions or point out all the things I'm doing wrong or how perfect my siblings are.
But Christmas is about family, is it not? And a time to put your problems aside?
Yes, but...
So I think you should go back. That's what I wish my Jennifer would do.
But I just stormed out.
It doesn't mean you can't come back.
That's why I wanted to call him.
And that was right.
The city can feel like such a bubble. Being immersed in all the noise and crowds. It can make you see everything differently.
family. It's important.
Yes.
Christmas is when you go home. It's what happens. It's not going backwards. It's comforting. Support. Familiar faces.
But it's late. It's Christmas Eve.
Go back now.
What about Jennifer? I haven't been very helpful.
You've helped me.
Really?
I know where she'll be now.
You do?
Yes. I'm certain.
Mr. Fielding? Mr. Fielding. Hello? Hello, Mr. Fielding.
Hello, please leave a message after the tone.
Dad? Hi, it's Grace. I'm so sorry. I know I shouldn't have just left like that. You must be so worried about me right now, but you don't need to be. I am okay. I'm okay on my own. That still doesn't mean I should have run away like that, but I know that Christmas is all about family, but I think I really want to stay out here this year. I'm so sorry. I know you and Mum were planning such a lovely time. I love you all so much. I just think right now I need to have a new kind of Christmas. Is that okay? Why don't you come and visit? It'll be different, but that can be good. Anyway, I'm really sorry for earlier, and please ring me back as soon as possible. I haven't been able to get a hold of you all day. Let me know.
Hi, I'm Rebecca King, the writer of The Winter Lamb, starring Lewis Almonacid and Tilly Palmer. This is a story about a farmer who decides to meddle too much with nature. What could possibly go wrong? Hope you enjoy.
Boots. What did I just say?
I'm going.
1, 2, 3, 4, 7 muddy footprints.
I'll clean them.
Will you? Seems like you conceived then.
You've seen her?
No. I've seen your face though. Guilty as you should be.
There's no guilt in it.
Out of season.
Annie, 'twas our great-grandfathers who chose the tupping season.
Aye, and they put it in the autumn where it ought to be, being best for you and lamb to birth in spring.
Is it best for Erdwick to bear wool enough for 50 jumpers? Shall I tell the Texels not to grow so fat, for it's not in their best interest to make so much meat? They're animals, Annie. We keep them fed and comfortable, and they repay the debt.
Dad would have said the same as me. When is she due?
Likely Christmas time.
As soon as that?
The market's ours if we can land before the rest. Strength in scarcity. You understand that much, don't you?
You'd be better off making holiday homes in the top field barns.
Holiday homes.
She'll freeze in that lambing shed.
I've said my piece.
Martin.
Steady, girl. Come along now. Skipper, come by.
You're getting too old for that there hill, brother.
I don't see you getting out to field too often.
Oh, I'm quite happy where I am. She's due.
Aye.
Looks like a frost tonight. Have a jolly merry time up in that shed.
Annie.
The answer is no. This is your doing, not mine. I'm not spending the night.
Annie, count the yows in the low field.
It's cold, Martin.
Count them, Annie. Are there 20 there?
Yan, tan, tetherer, metherer, hoverer, doverer.
20?
Aye.
You sure?
Aye, Martin. There's 20 ewes.
Go and have a look at them.
What?
One's not ours. Listen, here's 20. Should be 19 in the low field.
I've things to do. Go and look yourself.
I'll not ask you to help with the birthing if you do it.
Is that a promise?
Aye.
I'll remember it.
Take the dog with you.
Fine. Skipper. That'll do. Heel.
Unless both our sets of eyes are going.
What's it chiming for? 11, 12? How'd that happen? Martin, is that you there?
The dog won't piss.
What?
I opened the door for him and he won't go out and piss.
Did you put him out?
Aye, and he ran back in. You spoil him, he can't take the cold.
He can take the cold, Martin. He's thick furred as a polar bear. He must have been already.
Nope.
You sure?
You deal with him. The owl's gonna land tonight, I'm going up.
So you'll sleep up there?
Of course I will.
Martin, bring her here.
What?
It's just one ewe. You can bring her here and she can lamb in the kitchen.
On your nice clean floor.
I don't mind.
She'll be fine in the lambing shed where she belongs.
Are you not disturbed by it?
I don't mind the cold. And I don't mind pissing outside in it neither.
By the sheep, Martin. Are you not put out by it? There seem one more sheep than there should be.
What a terrifying turn of events.
Now come on.
You didn't look properly.
You and I both counted 20.
One got in from Harry Watson's field.
No, I know what our marks look like.
Then you didn't look close enough.
I bloody did.
Then one's going from the other field.
They were the same 20 we gave the worming powder to. They were all marked for it.
Well, maybe it's a wolf got in and taken time to make its costume. I'll deal with it tomorrow. Usually it's too few, not too many bloody things. It's just like sheep to pull a trick like that.
This morning there are no yolks in the eggs.
Huh?
No yolks, Martin.
The hens must have known that you prefer the whites.
5 eggs all without. That's never happened before.
You probably fed them something funny.
And now the dog won't piss. Something's not right, Martin. Something's not right in the field. Bring the ewe here.
No.
I'm going to worry.
Then you should have wed a man who wanted you to worry about him. Instead of staying here and blighting my house with your superstition.
Not your house. Not your house till you pay for your half of it. And you can't, can you? And you won't ever be able to if you keep on with the sheep. They barely pay for themselves. Should have given it up like all but 1 in 20's done round here, but you won't listen. Because you're off outwitting nature instead of changing your tack like a sensible man and selling something else.
Someone out there. It's all right. all right. Oh, girl. You're almost done. Don't worry now. It's nearly over. I should have been here. Damn my sister. She'll be driving me insane before she's finished. But all's as it should be. Come on there. Mother, you've done it before there. Easy, easy. Here's a blanket. Shall I help? One more push, girl. Push! There it is. Well done, girl. Well done. There you are. There's your mammy. Let's get all this stuff out. Your nostrils there, that's better, isn't it? Shut up!
Martin, for God's sake, Martin, look at you. Get up, come on. Get up and go have a shower.
What's happening?
You've been sleeping in the cold and the slime and you smell terrible. And your winter lamb is dead. Look, what did I tell you?
Did you hear it? In the night?
Hear what?
I don't know.
Go back to the house. You're not well. I'll see to this poor you here.
Come with me. Don't leave me.
Well, I'm not leaving her till she's fit to walk. You've done enough harm by her. Hello, girl. I've got no orphans for you, I'm afraid. She is calling for it. You'd better go take it away.
I'll wait for you.
Go and bury the lamb, Martin. Then wash yourself clean. You can help me with the Christmas cake and put this from your mind.
So far, which is quite the achievement considering they were all made during a national lockdown.
Haha, the ingenuity of humankind is truly remarkable.
Truly! I wish I could be human. Is that all? Can I go home to my wives now?
Not yet. I count 1, 2, 3, 4 more presents in the bag.
This one says, ooh, that sounds scary too. Voyage in the dark.
Oh, well then. Let's find out what's in the dark.
Hi, I'm Rishi Sharma, the writer of Voyage in the Dark, starring George Garrity as the officer, Ella Palmer as Becky, Marzia Zhu as Carla, Caitlin Molly Farrell as Sue, and Owen Iggyhorn as Archie. Narrated by Sophia McAdam and directed by Tom Howlett. This is a piece about a missing persons case on Christmas Day. Hope you enjoy.
A police station in England, Christmas morning, 2008.
So, we're finished with the standard questions, but I'd like to find out a bit more about you, just so we can get a better idea about how this all happened.
All right.
Sorry we have to keep you so long, and on a Christmas as well. It's just... we want to get the absolute best picture of what's happened here and...
Oh, it's not a big deal. Not like I have much else to do today anyway.
Put a right spanner in my plans, this has.
So, could you start by telling me about yourself?
Right, so my name's Becky and I live in... Well, you know what my address is by now. Right, well, anyway, just in case. I live in Barker House, which is this big block of flats. And I live with Rob. He's my fiancé, and it's his place. I've been living with him for ages, like 5 years or something. And we've been engaged the last three. I keep asking him when we're going to get married, but he keeps telling me we'll get married as soon as we have enough money for him to take me on honeymoon to Portugal. Which, I always wanted to go to Portugal and everything, but I've never been, so he said he'd take me. He's a real sweetheart, Rob is. He says he wants to treat me like a princess, and that's why he hasn't done the wedding yet, because he wants to do it all properly and with, like, a big cake and everything.
Give me a second there. All right. Can I ask you when you last saw Rob?
Because it's Christmas and everything, he got more money from work, like a bonus or something. And he had the day off, so we was going to... he was going to take me and we were going to spend the day together, you know? He said we'd go Blockbuster and get a DVD and we could watch the DVD back at his place because he has this new DVD player and he wanted to try it out. So basically, the night before, we were together at his place, like normal. He was sleeping on the sofa because he has his bad back and it helps him relax sometimes. And it...
So, the last time you saw him, he was asleep on your sofa?
Yeah, exactly. Well, not asleep. He was awake, watching something on the TV. He doesn't get much sleep some nights, especially with his back and all. But he was on the sofa, the one in the middle of the flat. You know the one. There was all your mates around there earlier today. Police, I mean.
Did you notice anything off about him? Was he in a different mood?
Oh, you know, he's always banging on about something. Today it was someone from where he works, his colleagues. I don't remember what he was saying exactly, but he was angry, yeah. But not more than usual, than average, if you know what I mean. He was all like, rah, 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 this, that and the other. And I was like, oh, get to bed, you old idiot, or something like that. Maybe I shouldn't have said that. He got annoyed at that. He gets annoyed like that sometimes. And now he's gone and everything. I don't know.
So, do you think that your argument has something to do with it?
You see, I don't know, really. I wouldn't call it a fight, really. He was just getting annoyed at someone from work. I don't actually know if what I did had anything to do with it. It's hard to tell with him and everything. He's not one of those people where you can tell really easy. Or maybe it's just because I'm not good at seeing what people are thinking. That's what my sister always used to tell me. Also, like, we haven't been talking too much these past few weeks. Not because we had an argument or anything. Just because his work got real busy. He said that to me, at least. Basically, he's been getting up really early, like 5 o'clock or something. That's what he tells me anyway, because I'm only awake at like 7. And then he goes to work and he gets back at like 10, 11. And he's shattered, so he doesn't want to talk too much.
All right, I'm coming. Thanks. Becky, I'll have to leave you here for just a minute.
That's all right.
Can I get you anything? Coffee? Tea?
Coffee would be nice, thanks.
How'd you like it?
You know, like, normal. I don't know. Rob always gets it for me. Got it. I mean, got it.
Don't worry. We'll find him, Becky. I promise you.
I like it sweet. I know that. He liked it bitter and nasty, but I didn't.
Right, you are.
Fuck, 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 fuck. He's not let this on, has he? Sneaky bastard. Jesus, who thought this would all be this complicated? You think you're so fucking clever, don't you, Becky? Report it on Christmas, that way I'll pay less attention. Too much fucking stupid telly. Shall I tell him about the other thing? He'll be more suspicious of him that way. Oh, but then that would get people involved. People always get nosy when... No. Run away. That's enough.
Sorry about that.
Something important?
Yeah. Yes, it was.
All right.
I wouldn't have been called out of this room if it wasn't important.
All right.
Here's your coffee.
Thanks so much.
Can we resume the interview?
Sure. Go ahead.
Right. So, do you have any idea where he might be right now?
They asked me this earlier.
Could you tell me again?
He said he needed to go abroad somewhere for work, but he never said what day or anything.
Did he say where he was going?
It sounded like dog. Or cat. I think it was cat. Yeah, Qatar. He said he needed to go to Qatar for business. It was weird because he never went on a business trip before. I didn't even know where Qatar was. I had to look it up.
Anywhere in the country where he could be.
His folks all live around here. Some of his family live in Belfast, which is a while away because it's like in another country or something. But I don't know if he went there. I don't know. I'm not good at geography. He never went anywhere usually. Just home, work, every day.
One moment, please. Thanks, Matt. So, something interesting here. My colleagues noticed that there are a lot of things missing from the flat.
Yeah?
Do you have any idea why that might be?
What do you mean?
As in, the TV is gone. DVD player. Everything. All the valuable items in the house are gone.
I know.
Well, what do you think about that?
Well, I mean, everything was there yesterday. Like, I told you, I think, that he was sitting in front of the TV. And it's all normal, you know. Well, I mean, like, normal as in we'd had an argument. Well, I wouldn't call it an argument, but, you know, one of those things. I thought he was going to hit me for a bit. But he didn't. This was when I called him an idiot. Well, I didn't call him an idiot. I called him a shithead for complaining all the time. But he hasn't hit me in ages, even though I've done all kinds of stuff. He's nice like that. He's the most understanding guy you'd ever meet. Literally. He takes spiders in glasses and puts them outside. And when I wake up, he's gone. And everything's gone. The whole lot. TV's been taken, DVD player. My jewellery that was in my drawer in his room. Our room. All gone. I had some really nice pieces as well that he bought me for my birthday, which was last week, actually. He's such a sweetheart. He never gets me joint presents, even though my birthday's so close to Christmas. But it was all gone. And it's weird because, like, I didn't even hear anything in the room when I was asleep. And I would have heard, because the drawer where all the jewellery was, it's right next to my head and everything.
Becky, I've something else I need to show you. Can you see these pictures?
Hmm.
They're from yesterday afternoon, in front of your apartment block. They're from a CCTV camera near your apartment block. The one on yours isn't working. Did you know that, Becky? Becky, is there something you're not telling me here?
A small house, England. Afternoon. Christmas 2008.
Bex, you're here. Well, come in, come in. You must be freezing. We're about to have lunch.
I'm starving, thanks.
They're having a great time. Kids, sit down. I know it's Christmas, yes, But that doesn't mean we go around running like headless chickens, does it?
Can we talk?
Yeah, of course we can. Look, kids, your Aunt Becky's here. Be on your best behaviour, okay? If you behave well, she's got a present for you both. And so far, it looks like only Lily's getting one. Now go and play in your room. My in-laws are here too, skulking around somewhere as usual.
They seem like they have it in for you.
Tell me about it.
Have you dealt with it?
He's gone.
And all the stuff?
Don't worry so much, sis. I've had it sent on. You'll live here while they deal with the apartment and everything.
But it's all under my name.
Look at me, Becky. I promise you. I promise you that whatever happens, you'll be fine. Someone will come around every morning with the post.
I'm not used to this.
This sort of thing happens all the time. Just try to stay calm. We have this all planned out. The Christmas idea was a good move. Now we just have to wait. How is the police station?
Fine. Fine. They brought him running away. He asked the question about CCTV footage, but I dealt with it.
You remembered what to say?
Yeah. Yeah, I said what you told me.
And the rest?
Yeah. Portugal, wedding. I did a lot of talking.
Good girl.
The money.
Don't worry about the money, Becky.
It's just, you know about my debt.
You won't have to worry about any of that, Bex. We're very grateful. All of us in the organisation are. Having this flat is very, very important to us. Helping you with money is the least we can do.
Thank you, Carla. Thank you so much.
That's what family's for, Becky.
I'm nervous.
It's all right to be nervous the first time, Bex. But the important thing is, I'm not nervous. In 6 months, it'll be just like normal.
It will never be normal without him, Carla.
Hey, we make do. We adjust. I'm here. We're here. Look, the in-laws are coming. Heya! Becky's finally arrived.
Terrific! We can get started now.
Kids! Lunch! All the turkey will be gone by the time you get here. Grandpa's very hungry, you know. He'll save you the sprouts.
So, Becky, how have things been going with you?
Oh, you know, all right, I guess.
Chris sends his regards, by the way. He couldn't make it on account of his work.
The rascal. No respect for their parents, our kids. Well, Chris at least. Couldn't even take Christmas Day off.
Well, you know how important his work is.
Not so important that he has to leave his old man to eat Christmas lunch without him. And after we've come all this way.
They've come from Salford.
Right.
So, Becky, how's Robbie doing?
Rob's,
you're new here.
What was that, honey?
He went missing.
Who? Rob?
Yeah. Took all the valuables in the flat and left. No sign of him. It's a real puzzler.
Why would Robbie do a thing like that?
Don't you ever feel guilt?
Guilt?
Yeah. I've had this knot in my stomach all day.
Guilt is a vapour. It's not real.
What?
What do you feel guilty about?
You're joking, right?
I'm not joking.
Everything. The last day, the last week.
Did you get in a car accident earlier today?
What?
I'm just wondering what happened recently that made you feel so guilty.
Rob!
Becky, we're not quite on the same page here.
I'll fucking say.
Don't use that language here, Bex. The kids will hear you.
Stop fucking patronising me. From the start, you've been nothing but cold to me.
Cold? I said earlier that I was with you, no matter what. That still stands. I'm just trying to figure out what's got you so worked up.
Rob! The whole thing with him, the flat, all our stuff's gone.
Becky, it's okay.
No, it's not! It'll never be okay for him. For me. I loved him. You knew that.
Calm down.
You took him away from me.
Listen, Becky. I need you to sit down. Understand?
Have you ever heard of the phrase zero-sum game? Well, it's what life is. You know that in life, there are winners and losers, right? A zero-sum game is when, for every winner, there's a loser. Remember that. If you want to win, someone else has to lose. You're not a naive girl, are you? You've never been naive, even when we were younger. You were always mature beyond your years, and I need you to be mature now.
You're heartless.
I'm not heartless. I'm a realist. Me and you, Becky, we're winners. Remember that. Nothing more, nothing less.
We're criminals.
We're not criminals. Do you think you're a criminal?
We're horrible, horrible people.
Do you think you're a criminal, Becky? Look at all those people who work in big banks for big companies. They're stealing a living from normal people, people like you and me. They're burning down the rainforest, they're buying out small businesses. Me and you, we have to make do. Winners and losers. They might be bastards, but they're winners and they know it. We're just trying to be winners as well. And we aren't half the bastards they are, not even a quarter.
You made me do it.
Do what?
I'm a good person. I don't want to do terrible things. But you made me do these terrible things.
I never made you do anything. You're naive, Becky. You always have been.
I'm not naive.
You're an optimist.
Myself and Sue were just going to take off. Everything all right here, Becky?
It's not a problem. Just the whole Rob thing. I think Becky's going to stay here for a little bit.
Well, that's perfectly reasonable.
I do hope you find him, Becky. Such a sweet young man.
If you need us, for anything, we'll be back home, but be sure to give us a phone call.
Thank you.
Well, ta-ra.
This is your song, isn't it, Becky? Remember back home, when we used to play charades at Christmas? Back when we had the house in Bexley?
Yeah, I remember.
Becky, he had to go. He had to.
Yeah?
Everyone at the company's very grateful, you know. They think you're a superstar.
They do?
What you did was so hard and so brave. That flat is really important to us. You did so well, Bex. You feeling better?
A little bit.
I have an extra present for you later. I think you'll like it. It's from all of us at the company to thank you for the flat.
All right.
Come on, get up. Let's dance. It's Christmas.
Christmas. It's a special time, a sacred time, a time to just be jolly, not jolly careful. That's why I've decided to spend this Christmas as a stick man. Take that, Hancock. While adjusting to my newfound freedom as a stick man, I thought I'd try my hand at being a writer. So today, I'm the writer of the next play, Moving Houses. Will it redefine comedy and the cultural landscape for years to come? No. It's just a fun little story about all sorts of unimportant things. But most of all, it's about home, about everybody's home, wherever that may be.
It's going to be a quiet Christmas, isn't it, Bai?
High Street's empty. Lights are on, but everyone's home.
I've only had two people pass me by in as many days. They didn't even look at me.
No cash, I suppose.
No one's ever got cash. I'd go contactless if I could. If I could.
No rest for the homeless, eh?
At least it's all new to you. I've been this way all my life. On the fringes. The outside looking in.
Suppose you've forgotten what it was like. Being warm. Loved.
At least we got a bit of sun today, eh, Stander?
Lonely. That's what it is.
Freezing sun, mind, but better than a nasty downpour.
Nothing's fixed. Nothing's certain. Got to be grateful for the pennies, I suppose. The friendly faces.
I don't know. Maybe it'll snow.
Do you hear something?
I'm sure it's just the wind.
No, it's something big. Like metal. Like... footsteps. What in Santa's name is that?
It's crushing the trees like bloody matchsticks. Santa.
What's the matter with them down there?
It's like they've never seen a suburban house with giant mechanical legs before.
To be fair, they probably haven't.
Why? Look out!
Sorry, mind where you're putting our feet, house?
Yes, I know, I know. No crushing the humans. You're so boring, Dad.
Well, I don't want us to be repossessed and carted away. Is that so wrong?
Are you all right?
You pushed me!
Well, you were about to be squashed by a 5-foot.
Oh, well, I suppose that's all right then. Thanks.
It's heading down the high street. Come on!
Come out, Esther! Come out and face me!
Okay, so how are we doing this? The old good cop, bad cop routine?
I was thinking more that I'll just be cop, and you be silent unpaid intern who sits in the corner taking pointless notes.
Ooh, sounds fun.
Idiot.
Stop. Just outside the estate agents. Stander, I think it's talking.
Esther! Come out, Esther! At last, some service.
Hello there. Do you, have an appointment, Mr...
House. I'm House.
Well, I can see that.
We're House, he means.
There's two of you.
I'm the patio extension.
For some reason, it came with a personality.
I see. Hold on, I recognise you now. You're that house we sold on Cheltenham Road, aren't you? Previous owners were...
Don't say their names. Just tell me, tell us where they went.
Hey, look, Bi. The back door's open.
So? You're not suggesting we...
Well, why not? Christmas wouldn't be so cold and lonely in a talking house now, would it?
Hey, he's writing they've got food.
Stacks of it, I bet. Tons of tins, platters of preservatives. Fit for a king, I bet.
Well, go on then.
I must say, this is all highly irregular.
I'm an irregular sort of house.
Evidently. I don't remember you being a mobile home.
Well, I don't get my legs out for strangers.
They were prospective buyers, not strangers.
Voyeurists.
Not voyeurists either. They own you now, completely and utterly. Where are they, by the way?
They were the wrong size. Didn't fit properly.
So we moved them out. Permanently.
You killed them!
No, of course not. We aren't monsters.
We just tilted over, like this, then shook ourselves around a bit, and they flopped right out the back door. Splat.
Shut up, Pat.
Evicting them was not your decision to make. You are a property, a commodity that they purchased, and they were quite within their rights to do so. I'm afraid I'll have to report you and have you repossessed immediately.
No.
That is the system.
Then the system is wrong. Now, Esther, the estate agent from the high street, you tell us where our old owners went, or I'm going to put my great big metal foot through your shop window and crush your display into powder.
No! That took weeks to arrange! Weeks!
Then tell us where our real owners went! Tell us now!
We finally done it, Bi. Finally made it off the streets.
It's huge. Too huge. This don't feel right.
What are you talking about?
The house. It might not want us here.
So, who cares what the house wants?
Floor
is moving. I don't like this, Stander. I don't like this at all.
It's standing up again. No turning back now.
I'm getting impatient, Esther. Last chance.
I can't. I mustn't. Client confidentiality. No!
He did warn you.
My display! You'll pay for that!
Will I?
No, get away!
Just look at this kitchen. A sink. Have you ever owned a sink before? And out of the window... Oh!
Put me down!
Is that old in her?
Some sort of metal claw?
Oh, so it's got arms now as well as legs.
You have no right! No rights! Let me go!
I remember how it felt, Esther, having you wander about inside me as though you owned the place, dragging in all sorts of muck from the streets, offering me up like I was a thing!
You are a thing! Houses, all of you, are just a commodity! You are invisible! You don't think, you don't feel, you don't exist!
Ah! He's shaking her.
I'm sorry! Ah, stop! Please!
Ooh, that does look nasty.
Tell me, Esther! Tell me where they went!
Just tell us, please.
I can't! The system!
And how much does that system mean to you? Ah! How many limbs?
Should we help her?
Don't see how. Just be glad it ain't us.
Which to go first, eh? A toe? An arm? A leg?
45 Orchard Way!
Say again!
45 Orchard Way. It's where they are, their new house. GGL 38, 9GH. Don't put me down!
Certainly.
Ah!
Oh, no, that looks even nastier.
It's all right. She's getting up. Oh, and she's down again. No, she's up.
Dazed. Going back through the window instead of the door.
Just look at all those homes. All broken. All that glass.
Just pictures, Stander. Just a window display.
But they all show a house that's real. I can't even imagine what it must be like being sold off like that.
Don't all houses feel like that? Or just this one?
It's all of us. It's just that rather than sitting on my plot feeling sorry for myself, I chose to actually do something about it.
Hey? Who's there?
Me. House, you nitwit.
And me. I'm here too.
Hello, Mr. House. Mr. Patio?
Pat. That's what my friends call me.
You don't have any friends, Pat. As for you two intruders, before you ask, no, you can't stay.
But we've nowhere else to go.
Well, cry me a U-bend.
I knew it. They're just like all the rest.
Oh, can't they stay? At least until we get to Orchard Way and get our old owners back.
Fine. But the second we arrive, they're out. Understand? Sit tight, you two. We've got a long journey ahead.
So dark outside. Haven't even turned the Christmas lights on. It's like they've given up.
Everyone's given up. Nothing's permanent anymore. Nothing's fixed. We just exist.
A very bleak midwinter. Where's Bai?
On the patio. With Pat. Watching the stars. You can see them out here in the country. Or so I hear.
He's used to the outside. Must be a bit much for him in here.
Have you always been homeless?
Not always. Not like Bai. I was quite a happy little chicken once upon a time. But my parents, they were difficult. Never standing still.
Homeless. That's how I feel. So many owners, always abandoned. But the last family, they felt different. It was like they really cared.
So you want to find them?
I didn't realise who Esther was at first. Who the strange families were, coming in and out. Never taking off their shoes. And then it was too late. Sold.
At least you have Pat.
Some comfort. He's listening to us now, you know. He can't help it. We're more than just joined at the hip. He's in my head, too.
That's why you hate him. He's part of you.
They put a little notice on my gate one day, asking if the neighbours had any objections to the build, the extension. Legal thing, you know. But they never asked me. Never once did it cross their minds that I might have been happier as I was. I made the boiler leak, drive out of the ceiling to try and say no. But they just replaced it, replastered, repainted, hiding the cracks. I don't hate him. It's just, he wasn't always there. I miss that. I miss who I used to be.
Maybe he just wants you to see him.
I do see him. What a bloody eyesore he is too. Just look at those tiles.
I heard that.
I know.
Do you know, I still can't get over the size. You fit 50 families in here, 100.
Not if I have anything to say about it.
I was wondering, House. What are you planning to do once you find your old owners?
We take them back.
By force, if necessary.
But isn't that a bit kidnappy?
Well, they should have thought of that before they sold me.
Us? I keep telling you.
Yes, we'll give them a stern talking to, make sure they've learnt their lesson, and clobber whatever new house they've bunked with for good measure.
We made it.
Nearly midnight. Christmas Day.
In an house of all places. Still can't quite believe it.
You're not staying.
But...
we gave you shelter for a bit, sure. But that's all. We'll have the old gang back together any moment now. And everything will be just fine.
41, 43... Out, I think I can see them.
Through the window. Silhouettes.
Couple. Putting presents round a tree. They look happy.
No. No, they can't be happy. They're not allowed to be happy. I want to be happy.
Why can't you be happy, House?
Because I need something. Something that isn't going to leave. Something that's going to stay put. So I can keep being me.
I'm here. I'm staying.
And what use is that? You don't get it, Pat. How could you? You're all shiny and new, but me? I've been replaced so many times. So many different parts of me have been reordered, thrown away. I'm not even sure what's left of what I used to be. I don't remember.
You're you, House. You'll always be you.
But what happens if a ceiling falls in, gets fixed, and starts talking? Or you, Pat, you start talking a little louder in my head. What happens to me then? Where do I go? I'm homeless. They were my home, those silhouettes. And now they've gone. Stolen by that tart. What's it got that I don't have? Bigger bedrooms? Better catchment area? Well, I can walk around on giant metal legs. I can be anywhere. Can it do that?
No, I don't think it can.
What?
The house, their new house, look at it.
At what? It's so dark.
Shapes. Metal.
A cage. It can't move. What? Why would they do that?
When did Esther first come to visit, Pat?
Just after they finished me. After I was born.
Your old owners, they're just like my parents. Project people. Middle-class families who are never, ever satisfied. Never, ever content with what they have. They just keep buying and building and selling. Browsing the estate agent's window for more treasures to plunder. Then throwing it overboard and starting again.
But this house is so perfect. It's so warm, so cosy. How could anyone ever want to leave?
It's too perfect. For them, anyway. They wanted something newer. A bit less permanent.
You poor thing. Poor 45 Orchard Way. Trapped under metal bars. Gutted, altered, and abandoned. Just like me. alone.
Except you're not alone, House. You were right. What you said to Esther, we're not a commodity. We're not just here to be used by them.
I just want a home, Pat. To be a home.
Maybe we can be that home, House. You and me, together.
Christmas Day.
I'd like that, Pat. Thank you. I'd like that very much.
Merry Christmas, House.
Merry Christmas, Pat.
Still quiet out there.
But less lonely.
Yeah, less lonely. Suppose we should be off then.
About that. Bye, Stander. Why don't you stay?
Really? What, he's really mean it.
Welcome to the family.
No. Welcome to the home.
So, this is it then. Two ex-homeless people, a sentient house on mechanical legs, and a tartan patio. Off to see the world.
Yep. Just one moving house from now on.
Oh, hello, I didn't see you there. My name's Gregory Miller, although I have been called other things. I was the writer of this little piece upcoming called Memento Mori. This is going to be the first 10 pages of a script which is currently in its infancy. It's about a wealthy merchant who is tired of the active life and would rather throw his lot in with the pensive bunch, really. Much to the chagrin of his two servants and his rather flummoxed business partner. So that's the piece, but it came to life with the help of four lovely actors. First, Lee, the inimitable Jago Wainwright. Give him a round of applause. Secondly, the venerable Nathan Galpin. Give him a round of applause. Two. Thirdly, the most assured, controlled and respectable Oscar Matthews. Round of applause there too. And then fourthly, leastly, but not lastly, apologies, lastly but not leastly, the obscure enigma that is Harry Fishlock. Watch out for him. So it's going to be the first 10 pages of a lovely piece. And what will hopefully be a lovely piece. And I hope you enjoy it. Now I'm going to go back to laughing at nothing, as is my custom. Thank you very much. Yes. Indeed. Ha!
Will you be wanting these skulls, sir?
Just put them at the foot of the bed, will you?
And what about this death mask of the late Schlegel, sir?
A bedside table.
Bedside table, Heinrich. And where shall we put the miserable painting, sir?
Which one?
All of them, I suppose, sir.
Just put them all over the walls.
Okay, all over the walls, Heinrich.
Also, could one of you two run my bath?
Of course, sir. Run his bath, Heinrich.
Run the bath? But what about...
Leave that to me. I'll sort it. Off you go.
Why haven't you moved any of the things I asked you to?
My apologies, sir. I tried to get Heinrich to do it, but he was insistent on running the bath.
Wouldn't surprise me, lazy scoundrel.
He's nothing of the sort. Simply diligent and conscientious, sir.
At any rate, you can put these things up now, can't you, Jenkins?
Yes, I suppose so, sir.
Jolly good. Right, I'm off to get ready for my bath. Let's hope that blockhead hasn't got his hot and cold taps the wrong way round again.
Don't worry, that will never happen again, sir. I scolded him quite severely after the event.
I doubt he was scolded as seriously as I was during the event. Now, when I'm back from my bath, I want all these memento mori arranged properly in the bedroom. Understand?
Yes, sir.
Your bath is ready, sir.
Good. I hope it's a soothing one this time.
It's handy that you're actually back, Heinrich. You can get on with arranging all these things.
What? I thought you said you'd sort it.
I have. I've sorted them into piles. For you to move.
I see. Sorry for not understanding.
Don't worry, it's easily done. Heinrich!
What?
Don't you find all this a bit odd?
What's odd?
Well, all this. It's been a little bit of out of the blue, hasn't it? Last week he was dining out at Lake Jussiers every night, flopping in every dawn, reeking of fish and ale, enjoying the arse end of the day more than the front. And now he's going for contemplation, like some ossified old priest. It stinks.
Stinks of what?
Of rotten incense and rotten prayers. Even more rotten than all those working women he's been bringing back from the inn recently. Tell you what, the stench of all those 10-pence sallies combined was a lot easier to scrub out of the sheets than this supposed piety will be. Don't understand it at all.
I don't see how it matters. He treats us terribly either way.
That's true.
I really wish Mr. Bruckheimer hadn't died.
That's a silly thing to wish. The man was in his 90s. He were alive now, he'd most likely be a vampire.
Mr. Bruckheimer was not a vampire.
I never said he was. Mr. Bruckheimer was a kind old man. But as you know, Heinrich, all kind old men must die.
That's when you end up with Mr. Jenrick.
Precisely. Are you all done?
Almost. Just these final few busts.
Makes a slave away while he gets to lie in his room and proclaim his virtue. Makes me sick.
Can we stop with this talk? I know he treats us terribly, but you do go on sometimes.
I do not go on.
You really do.
I do not. All right, I'll stop.
Good.
But can I just say one last...
No, you can't. I'm bored of this topic. Anyway, all the work's done now. Looks like there's a bit of a commotion outside. Come and look. Oh, stop sulking. Just come and look, won't you?
You're right. Wait. Who's that at the front? Is that Reinhard?
I think it is.
That'll be him and his little crew then.
His crew?
Well, if you could call an irate gaggle of social barnacles a crew, then they're a crew.
Perhaps gang would be a better word for them?
That'll have to do. At any rate, it's a more convenient term than codependent host and parasite.
Do you think this is enough for us to get Mr. Jenrick to call off the bath?
I feel that the gravity of the situation merits it.
Gah!
Though saying that, we may not need to call him at all. And Pat, here he comes.
Here, that water's bloody scalding! Have you ever had a bath before, you blockhead?
It was fine when I checked it last, sir.
Well, the sensation of one's skin melting may well be pleasant to you, but for me it was a little discomforting.
You may not want your bath now anyway, sir.
Why on earth not? Never in all my years living here have I missed my... Oh. Is that Reinhard?
Yes, sir. With a gang.
Well, I wouldn't call it a gang, Jenkins.
Perhaps they could be called a crew, sir?
Yes. It's a more accurate description. Well done, Heinrich.
Thank you, sir.
My, they do look irate. I suppose you'd better let them in.
Them, sir?
Well, only Reinhard, obviously. Wouldn't let those other little parasites crawl through my door, even if I had a disease and they had the cure. Just let me get myself ready. Now, where did you put my nightcap?
There, sir.
Ah, thank you. And did you get those new pillows I asked for?
Yes, sir.
And you did use goose feather?
Of course, sir.
And you did use Mr. Thompson's goose from down the road?
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. And so begins the rest of my life. You two go and let him in.
Don't worry. I'll deal with this. Hello?
Is Master Jenrick in?
Sorry?
Are you deaf, man? I asked if your master was in. I must speak with him urgently.
Our master? We have no master.
What? But of course you do, Master Jenrick.
You must be confused. You see, we are employed by Master Jenrick, but he isn't our master.
Rubbish. Where'd he pick you two up? The local shambles. You both stink like one, at least. But I haven't the time to insult you, so I'll ask again. Is Master Jenrick in?
He is, yes.
Will you let me through?
I suppose I...
Oh, enough of this. Where is he exactly?
Just through there, in the master bedroom.
What's he doing in there? It's 3 o'clock.
I suppose you'd better go through and find out, haven't you?
Jenrick, we need to... What's all this? What's going on?
I'm dead, Reinhard.
Dead?
Indeed. You are looking at a dead man.
I wish I was. At least then I might have a will coming my way.
I wouldn't hope for that. Perhaps I ought to clarify, Reinhard.
I think you'd better.
What I mean is that to the world I'm dead. I'm above and beyond earthly goods. Should I clarify further? Okay. I've been thinking, ever since last Sunday, really, about my life. I daren't say it's been a bad one, and I've certainly got one or two things done. But recently I realised that it all felt a tad hollow. When death comes, as it eventually will for me and for you, will I be prepared? Who wants to face that great wave of infinity with nothing but fear and uncertainty? And they always say that the best way to prepare for death is to remind oneself of it constantly. Or at least, that's what all the philosophers say. So, for the rest of my life, I shall live withdrawn in this bedroom, surrounded by all these darling Memento Mori. I've made my money. I can certainly afford it.
But, Jenrick, you're not even that old.
What does that matter? I could die next week, for all you know. Or tomorrow. Hell, I could die of a heart attack right now.
Look, if anyone's likely to die of a heart attack right now, it's certainly not you. What about our business?
What about it? Don't worry. I'll sell you my half.
What? But that's our business. You can't just sign your half away like that.
Oh, it's our business now, is it? Well, maybe you could do what I've been doing for the past 12 years or so with our business. You can manage it, can't you?
Of course, I can manage it, but...
Then what are you so stressed about?
You've been acting up for a few weeks now, coming in late, drunk. I gave you the benefit of the doubt. But I knew you were upset about me and Janice getting engaged.
Not at all.
But this is taking things too far.
This isn't about you and Janice. This is about me getting to heaven.
Don't let's kid ourselves here. We both know who has always done the work in this company.
Nice to see it recognised now.
That's how it's been since university. You do all the boring essentials and I bring the social element.
The social element? I suppose that's your term for getting smashed in all the clubs around town?
I bring publicity. You know I won't be able to manage it by myself. The company will go down the tubes. I might even have to call off my engagement. If you don't want to do it for me, do it for Janice. I know you used to have some feelings for...
I have no feelings for Janice! I simply want to live a quiet, philosophical life. That's all. You haven't even visited this house for years. You're hardly one to barge in now and give me life advice.
How can you spend the rest of your life in this room, especially with those two idiots running around outside? I wouldn't trust them for a second. Insolent plebs they are. They didn't even once address me as sir. They'll probably kill you and rob you, knowing that lot.
I will not hear them be slandered in such a way, Reinhard. They're people, not slaves. They weren't cheap either. I got them from some old fellow merchant I used to dine with. Master Bruckheimer was his name. They were ever so diligent and conscientious. But they were treated horribly. The man was a veritable scoundrel with them. I felt so bad about it. I offered to pay for their services. I go out of my way to treat them equally. In fact, this evening, I might even go so far as to dine with them.
Dine with them?
Yeah, but of course. In fact, I'll call them in now, shall I? Oh, Jenkins, Heinrich, can you come in here, please?
Yes, sir.
Have you both done everything I asked you to do?
Yes, sir.
Good. Then why don't you take the rest of the day off? Go shopping if you want. Here's some money for you.
How much?
Nothing's too much for my favourite two servants in the whole wide world. Now, get out of here, you rascals. See? I treat them well.
Well, I won't be troubling you any longer. I can see you've gone completely mad. Good day. What are you still doing here? You should be out enjoying your spoils before they cart your master off to Bedlam. Bloody parasites.
You know what, Reinhard? You're absolutely right. We are parasites. We put in so much work, don't we? So much work. All to suck the blood from fat, great, immobile hosts like yourself. After all, what right have we to work so industriously, to slave away just to suck a tiny fraction of blood out of that glutted body of yours? Hardly fair, is it, sir? So yes, we are parasites. But hopefully, one of these days, we won't need to be. I'm sure we can agree on that.
You'll pay for this talk, you hear. Give me my coat.
Don't do it, Heinrich. Don't humour him. There he goes. Back to his crew.
How could you talk to him like that?
How can... Did you not hear the way he talked to me?
But he can talk to you like that, and you can't. Like it or lump it. Did you hear what he said when he went? He could have us kicked out of our jobs.
Reinhard! Be reasonable, Heinrich. The man could be a bellows for all the hot air he blows. He's about as effective as a penguin in a foundry.
Still, you keep talking like that and someone will catch wind of it. Just be grateful for what you have.
Grateful for what? For this? When can we have her freedom?
We were free before and we were poor as hell.
I'd rather be back down at the docks.
You don't know what you're saying. Did you not hear how Master Jemrick talked in there? Giving us the day off. Eating with us. It'll be just like it was with Master Bruckheimer.
You're telling me you believe that spiel?
It wasn't spiel.
Jenkins, Heinrich, in here now. I trust you still have that money I gave you.
Yes, sir.
Good. Hand it back then.
Sorry? I thought you said we could spend it.
My God. You didn't believe that, did you? It was obviously a joke.
Oh. And I suppose all that stuff about having the day off and dining with you in the evening was a joke as well, sir?
But of course.
Oh. I see. A real humdinger, sir.
It was rather, wasn't it? Now get back to work. The living room needs to look a lot more philosophical. A shelf with a few works of theology on it would do the trick. Nothing too seditious, though. Renowned enough to earn respect, but conventional enough to not arouse suspicion. In fact, you can use this money to go out and buy the books.
We'll get on it right away.
Good. get on it. You may both be blockheads, but you're eager blockheads, and that's what I like. Go on, off you go. I have various tasks I have to get on with myself.
What did I tell you? He's nothing like Master Bruckheimer.
Perhaps he just needs to warm to us.
It's been 3 years! That idiot doesn't warm up to anyone. He'll only start to warm up when he's in hell. And even then only a little.
Please, stop this kind of talk. You've been doing it more and more recently. I don't like it.
How would you have me talk? Like I'm happy? We're better than this kind of work. I can feel it.
I blame it on Master Bruckheimer teaching us to read. You read some funny books in that library of
his. It was because he knew we were better than this. He was a good man. One of the few of that type I've met. But this one. For all the smelly, slimy fish I used to chop up on that dock, none of them were as slippery as this one. Sometimes I think. No. No. I couldn't do it.
Do what?
Nothing. Now, let's go out and buy some respectable theology, eh?
After you.
Hi, I'm Sophie Brawn, the writer of Secret Santa, starring Jack Ward as Ali, Estera Ulrich Olteyan as Sammy, Oliver Udy as Cameron, Owen Ijihon as Jake, Dominika Wiatrowska as Emily, Jasmine Ventham as Chloe, and directed by Sol Bailey. This is a piece about a group of student housemates opening Secret Santa presents. No one is supposed to know who their present came from, but things get heated when someone is offended by their present and no one will own up to it. Please enjoy.
All right, it's 6 p.m. Let's get started.
But Chloe's not here yet.
Sorry, Jake, but she knew what time we were starting, and if she can't be bothered to turn up on time, then we shouldn't have to wait for her.
Ali, we're opening Secret Santa presents, not having an executive meeting.
This isn't just about opening Secret Santa presents. This is our first Christmas sharing a house together, and I want it to be as special as possible.
It's the 5th of December.
Well, we'll all be going home next week, so it's as close as we can get. And it's never too early to start celebrating Christmas.
Those of us with a November birthday may be inclined to disagree.
If you're so desperate for this to be special, then surely you should want to wait for Chloe to show up, so we can all celebrate together as a household.
Actually, I have a report I really need to finish, so it would be good if we could get this over with as soon as possible.
Do you ever not have a report to finish?
They are quite a significant portion of my degree.
All right, that makes it 2-2. Come on, Cam, surely you think we should wait for Chloe?
Actually, I'm afraid I agree with Ali, so that's 3-2 to us.
Of course you'd take his side.
There.
What? Oh yes, their side, sorry.
It's fine, Sammy, no worries.
Who gets to go first then?
If Ali's so desperate, then they should open theirs first.
It's not that I'm desperate. I just think that if people make plans at an agreed time, then they should respect that time. It's just rude not to.
It's fine, Ali. We get that. But this whole thing was your idea, so it'd be fitting if you opened yours first.
Aw, that's so sweet, Cam. But honestly, I'm not first.
We're all going to have to open our presents eventually. Just get on with it.
You're fine with this too, Emily?
Yes, please, go for it.
Okay, great. Oh my gosh! This is amazing! Oh, thank you so, so much.
What is it?
Looks like a record.
It's the new Arctic Monkeys LP. They're like my favourite band ever. This is just perfect. Oh, I can't wait to try it on my record player.
Wasn't there supposed to be a £10 limit?
Well, someone clearly didn't stick to it.
I wonder who.
Now, everyone remember the absolute golden rule of Secret Santa is that no one knows who their present is from.
Or what? Does a reindeer die or something?
Jake, why don't you open yours next before anyone accidentally lets something slip?
Well, if you insist. Oh. Wow.
OMG. That's the most adorable Ted you've ever seen.
Looks like you've got yourself a secret admirer.
Looks like something someone picked up in a Valentine's Day sale.
I wonder who it could possibly be.
And that is on cue to move on to the next present. Emily, why don't you go next?
Oh, sure. Okay. A pot of hummus.
Oh, that's nice. You like hummus, don't you?
Sure. I mean, I eat it. It's all right. Yes, thank you. That's great. Thanks. Whoever that is, thanks a lot.
But remember, no one say who. Oh, this is so much fun, isn't it?
Time of my life.
Come on, Sammy, lighten up. Here, why don't you go next? That should get you into the spirit of things.
Okay, fine. Pass it here. What the fuck? You think this is funny? I don't think this is fucking funny.
And I can't explain why, but somehow that makes it funnier.
I don't get it. It looks like a dog collar?
It is a dog collar.
So?
So, someone is obviously calling me a bitch, aren't they? Or they're saying I need to be more obedient, need to be tamed.
I think you might be reading a little bit too much into it.
Regretting your little insult now, are you? Didn't think I'd have the balls to kick up a fuss in front of everyone else.
Hold up. You think this was me?
Guys, we're not supposed to be discussing who the presents came from.
Oh, shut up, Ali. Cameron crossed that line when he decided to degrade me in front of our entire house. Dumping me in front of my best friend, not enough for you.
What? I didn't dump you. We mutually agreed that things weren't working out. And Chloe was only there because you insisted on bringing her along. When I want to have a private conversation with you.
Because I knew you were going to dump me, and I needed the emotional support. Given how spiteful you can be, it looks like I made a sensible decision.
You know what? You're right, Sammy. I did buy you that dog collar, and it must have been someone else who bought Ali that CD of their favourite band. Someone else who spends long evenings discussing music with them, and who would be willing to go over the limit on a very personalised present for them.
You must have got Jake to do it then.
Whoa, don't drag me into this.
You were the one who was literally laughing in my face when I opened it.
Exactly. You think I'd be stupid enough to do that if I was the one who'd bought it?
It could have been a double bluff.
You think I'm clever enough to do that?
Fine. It must have been Emily then.
Me?
Yes, you.
Emily wouldn't do something like this, Sammy.
How do you know that? None of us really know anything about her. She spends all day locked in her room, probably concocting all sorts of sick little plans like this to get back at us, because she's so jealous of us.
I'm not jealous of you, Sammy, and I didn't buy you the dog collar. I didn't even get you in the Secret Santa.
Then who did you get?
What?
Come on then. If you didn't buy my present, then tell us whose present you did get.
We're not supposed to say though, are we?
No, we're not! You guys are really ruining the spirit of Secret Santa here.
The spirit of Secret Santa was already ruined by whoever decided to use your little child's game to attack me.
It's not a child's game. It's actually...
Just leave it, Al.
So go on, Emily. Tell us whose present you bought.
I don't want to.
Just leave it, Sammy. We can sort it out later.
We are sorting it out now. Tell us who you bought a present for. Silence will be taken as evidence of your guilt.
That's not fair. That's not how the legal system works.
Well, in case you hadn't noticed, we aren't in court, honey. And in the real world, the innocent don't have anything to hide. You know, I always had you down as a snivelling little coward, but it's still such a shame to have it confirmed.
I'm not a coward. I didn't buy you that stupid dog collar because I got Jake's present instead.
You bought my present.
Disappointed?
No. No, it's just a surprise. I didn't realise you felt this way.
Yeah, well, I do, so, yeah, sorry.
No, you don't need to apologise. It's, like, super sweet. Thank you so much. It's just, I don't really feel the same way. Sorry.
It's all right.
I really, really like you, just not in that kind of way.
No, it's fine. I never should have bought it, really. It was stupid.
Well, see, guys, this is what happens when you break the Secret Santa rules.
You're really going to blame that for this?
Well, yes. The whole point of this game is getting to anonymously send a present to your friend without them ever finding out which one of their friends it is. So it's like they're actually getting a present from all their friends.
Is it though?
Well, yes, because you take the love and care you felt when you received that one present and you assume it came from all your friends.
So, by that logic, I should be pissed off at all of you then.
I thought you were.
It also means we're all in love with Jake.
Again, I see no flaws in this hypothesis.
Don't go talking all science-y now, Jake. You'll turn Emily on.
Shut up, Sammy. No one was supposed to find out.
I'm sorry, but you don't buy someone a present like that without wanting them to find out.
Hey, Cam, why don't you open your present next? Get a new argument started so we can move away from this one.
Sure. Ah, it's a collection of poems by Keats.
Someone got you schoolwork. Lol, what a letdown.
Not for those of us who actually enjoy our degree. I actually really like this present. It's very sweet and thoughtful. Thank you to whoever got it for me.
Unbelievable.
What?
Nothing. It's just, it's pretty damn convenient that the person organising the Secret Santa somehow ended up both receiving and giving a present to the person he blatantly fancied.
It's they, Sammy.
Oh, yes, fine. Whatever.
No, not whatever. This isn't just some minor thing, Sammy. This is who I am. It's been 2 months now and you keep slipping up all the time.
Well, I'm sorry. But I did know you as male for a year beforehand, so it can be quite hard to change these kinds of habits.
You're sure that's all it is, though?
What?
It's just, ever since I started identifying as non-binary, you've been really off with me.
Hold up. Are you accusing me of being transphobic?
I'm not accusing you of anything.
It certainly sounds like you are. This is disgraceful.
Oh, come on, Sammy. You got to admit they're right, though. You've been acting funny around Ali for ages. We've all noticed her.
Yeah, but it has nothing to do with their gender identity. I am and always will be a strong ally to the trans community, and I'm highly offended at any suggestion to the contrary.
So what's your problem with them then?
My problem, Cameron, is that they're the reason me and you broke up.
What?
Oh, right.
What do you mean, all right? Don't say all right like that makes any kind of sense.
Sorry, ma'am, but I thought it did make sense. Honestly, I kind of figured the reason you and Sammy broke up was so you could be with Ali.
Are you for real?
See, it's not just me that noticed.
Shut up, Sammy. Ali isn't the reason you and me broke up.
Oh, really?
Yes, because Isaac was.
Who's Isaac?
I have no idea.
Come on, Sammy, don't play dumb.
Seriously, I don't feel like I've ever met someone called Isaac.
Then how come Emily saw you making out with him outside Sainsbury's?
You little bitch! I told you she's obviously crazy jealous of me. What more proof do you need?
Why would I be jealous of someone stupid enough to cheat on their boyfriend in a public place?
Say that again, I dare you.
Back off, Sammy. Besides, after Emily told me about this, I asked around, and it turns out she's not the only one who knew you were mugging me off. You weren't exactly being subtle about it. Almost as if you wanted me to find out.
Maybe I did want you to find out. So you knew how it felt to have to watch you and Ali every single day shoving it in my face.
Shoving what in your face? The concept of two people actually liking each other? I know that's very hard to come by around here at the moment.
What's that supposed to mean?
Oh, come on, mate. You know I wasn't talking about you.
Well, why not? I thought the two of us were best mates, but apparently I'm the only one in the house who didn't know you were being cheated on.
Look, it's not like that. I only didn't tell you because I knew you'd make a huge fuss and have a go at Sammy for it.
Hell yeah, I would.
And it would make you do something stupid.
Like buy me an offensive present.
Oh, for fuck's sake, Sammy, I didn't buy your stupid dog collar. I wish I had now, but I didn't.
Whose present did you buy then? Don't tell me you and Cameron have recently started sharing a love of 18th century poetry.
Actually, Keats was 19th century.
No one cares.
You want to know whose present I bought? Fine.
Hey, that's Chloe's. You can't open someone else's present. That is absolutely crossing the line. Oh my.
Are those condoms?
£10 worth, I assume.
I dread to think of the quality if you got that many for £10.
I may have nicked a few from the welfare office to pad it out a bit.
Why?
It's funnier if there's more of them.
No, I mean, why did you buy Chloe condoms?
Bit on the nose, isn't it?
What?
Well, that was the point, you see, it's... Me and Chloe have been sleeping together, just like casually, but I was sort of hoping it might be turning into something more serious.
And how exactly does a box of condoms say that?
We all have different ways of expressing our affection, okay? I just wanted it to be out in the open, so everyone in the house knew, not a dirty little secret anymore. Look, Emily, I'm really sorry.
No, it's fine. You haven't done anything wrong. I'm sorry I led you on by buying the bear. It was stupid.
It wasn't stupid. It was sweet. It was stupid of me to think Chloe would do something like that. She's not that kind of girl.
Then why do you want to be with her?
I just... Love is complicated.
Tell me about it.
Wow. I can't believe this has been going on right under our noses and we had no idea.
Yeah, crazy.
You knew, didn't you?
Yeah, I did.
Because I actually like to talk to my best mate about important stuff like that.
Look, Matt, I'm sorry. It just didn't seem worth telling you about.
The end of our relationship didn't seem worth telling him about.
That's not what I meant.
Isn't it?
Oh my days, why is everyone ganging up on me now? I'm not even the one who bought the stupid dog collar and started this mess.
Surely we can work it out now. We basically know who bought what for everyone else.
Oh, that's really not in the spirit of secrets.
I'm sorry, Al, but I think we're really past that now.
Okay, so Cameron obviously got Ali the CD. They got him the poetry. We know Emily got Jake the bear.
Wait, so who got Emily the hummus?
Oh, that was me.
Obviously.
What's that supposed to mean?
I'm sorry, but hummus. For Christmas, you bought me a pot of hummus.
You like hummus.
I also like porridge. Why didn't you buy some instant packs of that to go with it?
At least I managed to stay within the £10 spending limit.
You could have bought four pots and stayed within the £10 spending limit. This is Sainsbury's own brand.
It's the type you have in the fridge.
Because I'm a poor student on a budget.
Well, I'm sorry, Emily, but what else was I supposed to get you? I don't know anything else about you. I only know you like hummus because it's there every time I open the fridge with your name written all over it. Like anyone would want to steal that cheap stuff. I've seen more of that hummus this term than you. It's the one I should have been getting a present for.
I'm sorry that some of us came to university to actually get a degree and not just party all the time.
I don't party all the time. It's called having a healthy work-life balance. You should try it sometime.
Even if I did socialise, I certainly wouldn't want to do it with you people.
I knew it. I knew you looked down on us.
Look down on you? Earlier you were saying I was jealous of you.
Jealous of the fact that we actually like the people we're living with.
Do you? Because based on today, none of you seem to like each other very much at all. When Ali invited me to live with you guys, I thought it would be fun. Sharing a house with such a close group of friends. I thought it would create a really homely atmosphere. But the atmosphere here is toxic.
Well, we all know whose fault that is.
Oh, shut up, Cameron. We all know you've been trying to get it on with Ali from the minute we started living together. And frankly, I'm amazed that Sammy didn't dump you sooner. It was fucking disgusting.
Oh, because you're such a relationship expert. Desperately in love with a girl who doesn't see him as anything more than a fling.
Well, at least I'm actually in touch with my feelings. You think reading poetry makes you all deep in shit, but you're such a poser.
Guys, stop this!
Jumping to your boyfriend's defence now, are we?
What? No, I just want everyone to stop. This was supposed to be a nice house activity, which brought us all close together, and you're ruining it with all your arguing.
We're the ones who ruined it. You're the one who wanted to start without Chloe.
What's that got to do with anything?
Haven't you guys worked it out yet? She's the one who bought Sammy the dog collar. If she would just been here from the start, this all could have been avoided.
But why would Chloe buy me a dog collar?
I can think of a few reasons myself, but you would have to ask her. Now, if you will excuse me, I'm off to go finish my report. Thanks for arranging this, Ali, but feel free to leave me out of any group activities in the future.
Why were you so desperate to start without Chloe anyway?
Well, I told you, being late to social events, even informal ones planned with your friends, is just rude.
I don't buy it. There's something more going here.
Yeah. You weren't this anal when Jake turned up late to the housewarming party at the start of term. What's your problem with Chloe?
Oh, fine! I just don't like her, okay? She's so whiny and stuck up, and she's such a bitch if she doesn't get her own way.
I feel like you just described Sammy.
Drop dead, Cameron.
Well, yeah, but at least Sammy is upfront about things. If she's upset with you, then she'll tell you to your face.
Chloe will just say everything's fine, but then go around being all passive-aggressive for the rest of the day. It really pisses me off. And she keeps using all my almond milk. What's that all about? Like, I can appreciate borrowing a little bit every now and then, but it's like she's using it for every single cup of coffee. Buy your own damn milk.
Hey, guys. What's going on?
Chloe. Nothing much. How's it going?
It's going fine. Did you guys start without me?
It would be more accurate to say we finished without you.
Did someone open my present for me?
We were trying to work out who bought Sammy the dog collar.
I bought Sammy the dog collar.
We know.
But why?
I thought you said your parents were getting you a dog for Christmas.
I never said that. Why would they get me a dog for Christmas? I'm in my second year of university.
Oh. Sorry, I must have misheard.
Oh. Right.
What did I miss, guys? There's a proper dodgy vibe going on in here at the moment. Where's Emily?
She had a report to finish.
Does she ever not have a report to finish?
I know, right? Wanna come to my room? I'll fill you in on everything.
Sweet, sounds good. Wait, first, who got me in the Secret Santa then? Where's my present?
Oh, I did. And I got you this teddy bear.
Oh my. That's so sweet. You shouldn't have.
I really like you, Chloe. I think I might be in love with you.
Thank you, Jake. See you guys later.
Thank you. Ouch.
Fuck off, Cameron. Go dry hump alley whilst listening to your indie music and reciting some dead guy's poems.
Well, this is all my fault.
Don't say that.
It is, though. I'm the one who organised this event, and it's torn our house apart.
I don't think this has created any cracks that weren't already there. Anyway, if it's anyone's fault, it's mine.
How?
I fixed the name draw, so I would get you, and you would get me, which probably caused a considerable portion of this mess.
But why would you do that?
Because there was only one person in this house I really wanted to get a present from. And only one person I wanted to get a present for.
Oh. Well, that's not really in the spirit of Secret Santa.
Sorry. So, want to go listen to some Arctic Monkeys?
I actually have an essay I need to finish. Sorry. Maybe later?
Maybe later then.
See ya.
Fuck.
Ho ho ho! Well, that brings our holiday special to a close.
They were all so good!
Wonderful.
Weren't they just? The students of Cambridge are going to be so delighted with this year's gifts, I'm sure of it. But first, we've got to deliver them. Come along, tally-ho, Sally the reindeers. I want to set off pronto.
Okay, Sugar Plum, we got to get the fuck out of here.
Shh, you'll hear we drop the voices.
He won't hear. You think I'd let us drop the voices in front of him? You remember what happened to Andy?
Yeah, he's got no skin now.
I think this guy actually thinks he's Father Christmas.
And he actually thinks we're elves.
And what the hell is the Marlowe Society?
The Marlowe Society is a Cambridge University theatre club for Cambridge students.
Shut the fuck up.
Sorry.
We're gonna get this guy locked up, Sugarplum.
Hell yeah.
Then we'll kick back, relax.
And have a very,
very
Merry Christmas.
Thank you so much for listening to the Hatch Holiday Special. I really hope you enjoyed it. I just want to say a huge thank you to all of the writers, all of the actors, all of the directors, editors, everyone who's been involved in this. We really hope you enjoyed listening to them. Thank you very much to my flatmates, Towhid and Oscar, for recording that Santa subplot at 3 in the morning one night. And thank you very much to you for listening. Wherever you are, however you're celebrating, have a very safe and restful holiday period. From the Marlowe Society, Merry Christmas, good night.
And it is so long till death will come. Cuttity cut. May not use all of that, but eh, it'd be fun. Right, that seems to be about the time. Right, I better leave this video alone. Right. Thank you very much for your time.